Senator Paul, thank you so much for joining us
today.
Thanks
for having me.
Now, I know that you haven't officially declared that you're going to run for president in 2016, but you did slip up and say that you're a candidate in a tweet yesterday. So I'm a generous person. I want to give you the chance to make history right now and be the first person to announce that you're running for president
on MTV.
It's never been done.
Well, you know, I am a candidate for the U.S. Senate, and so I'm thinking about the presidency, but we haven't made a final decision, but we're getting close. I mean, the next couple of weeks, we're probably going to make a final decision.
All right, the offer's still on the table, though, if you really want to announce that you're running for president, just so you know.
No.
Okay. So we're at South by Southwest. I know you're here for work. You spoke on a panel yesterday, but I hope you've been having some fun. Have you been out to parties? Have you heard any music that you've liked?
Yeah, we heard Mark Ronson the other night. We were at the Pandora party and had a great time there, and... Yeah, we've had a good time.
I'm jealous that I didn't get that invite, by the way.
Oh, no, you were on the list. We were waiting for you.
Okay, so that was my fault. All right, got it. Now, you're a big supporter of technology and innovation, but with tech, there are privacy issues as well. Do you think the government should be able to regulate what information companies can and can't collect from us online, even when we're using social media apps, for example?
Right. I think it all should be done by agreement. Mm-hmm. Basically, when you get on any kind of platform or any kind of website, you should have to voluntarily agree or disagree, you know, whether you want to share your information. And for the most part, the internet has worked well. If we try to regulate the transfer of information, that's how money is made online, and I'm afraid that would destroy the internet. I'm more concerned about the government looking at my information without permission. So when I think of privacy, I can voluntarily share my information online, and I get, you know, maybe sold things that are similar to things I just bought, but that's the way the internet works. But I do that voluntarily. But I don't want the government looking at my stuff and finding out, you know, am I Jewish? Am I gay?
Are you
am I Japanese? Am I hanging
night?
Around with Mark Ronson? Or are there things about me the government could then use against me?
Mm-hmm.
And could it be such that I have to worry about my activities because they're being monitored? So I think the government should only look at my activities if I've been accused of a crime, if they go to a judge and they convince a judge that someone is a possible criminal, that's when you look at the information. But they shouldn't be collecting all of our data all the time. It concerns me that the government is collecting in bulk all of our phone data and storing it somewhere. I think that is rife for abuse.
Okay. And now social media. This is going to be a big part of your campaign. We know that you're a big fan of Snapchat, but what is it that you like about Snapchat and how do you plan to use it specifically to reach a younger audience?
I think if you want to get to voters, you got to go where they are. I have three teenage boys and they're not really watching the news networks. They are on Snapchat, Twitter, MTV.
Yeah.
There are different places. So I think you have to go where voters are. But I think the one thing that binds young people together is that what they do on their phone, I think, is none of the government's business.
Okay. Did your boys teach you how to use Snapchat?
Yeah.
Okay. Just need to check.
They got me on Pandora. They've, you know, my kids have, they get me hooked up. They get
me
connected.
Okay, so you're a cool dad.
I don't know. That's open to debate, probably.
So when your dad was campaigning now, he was good at connecting with college students. You've been visiting a lot of schools as well, including historically black colleges and universities. So in addition to sharing your ideas when you give speeches there, what have you actually learned from the students?
You know, what I've learned is that, you know, the promise that Martin Luther King gave us back in the 60s of everybody being treated equally under the law, we're getting closer and closer to that. Under the law, I think it's pretty good. But there still are two Americas. Martin Luther King talked about there being two Americas, mm-hmm. and there is somewhat of a separation where there are people in our country, predominantly people without money, without resources, who really aren't getting treated the same by our criminal justice system, who don't have the same economic opportunities. So I don't think we've quite overcome every obstacle that we have to making everybody equal in our country. And I want to be part of trying to figure that out and coming up with solutions.
Okay, absolutely. And so something recent happened. A racist fraternity video leaked from the University of Oklahoma, and the hashtag not just SAU was trending after that. People were sharing stories basically trying to prove that's not an isolated incident. Incidents like this happen pretty often. Are you surprised that this is still a thing happening, especially among such young people?
You know, I guess I just don't know what goes on college campuses. I think in many ways we've gotten beyond a lot of that,
mm-hmm.
but there still are probably vestiges of it, and I think trying to eradicate sort of things like that is still in our best interest and still something we should strive for.
Okay. You visited Ferguson. You've spoken a lot about racial inequality in the criminal justice system, in the judicial system. So I'm wondering, do you think that white privilege is something that still exists?
I think there's privilege. I don't think it's so much racially based anymore. It happens to be maybe that there might be more poverty in the African-American community.
Mm-hmm.
So there is still a difference that's racially based. But I think the good thing is we've gotten beyond sort of the legal separation, the legal sort of problems. I think there still is a problem in the criminal justice system, though, in the sense that the war on drugs, I think, has unfairly incarcerated a disproportionate amount of African Americans and Hispanics, but also poor whites as well. If you're poor in America, you're more likely to be trapped. The reasoning is not that you're being targeted, it's just that the police don't do a lot of tours in the suburbs.
Right.
And so teenage kids, white kids, rich kids in the suburbs are also smoking pot. They're just not getting caught. And so I think the war on drugs needs to be reassessed. I think it's been unfair to a lot of people. We've got people in jail 55 years for selling $300 worth of pot. Yeah. That's just wrong, that's unfair, and we ought to change it.
Okay, you've spoken a lot about women's rights as well. You think that they're doing pretty well. You mentioned that a lot of women are enrolling in colleges, which is great, but a lot of working class women are still getting paid a lot less than men are. So do you think we're actually close to closing the gender gap?
I think we're getting a lot better than we used to. And I think the one of the things that we find is that when you compare individual job, announcer on MTV to another announcer on TMT, there actually is quite a bit of parity if it's actual job for job. If you just want to compare two genders, there still is a difference, and there are many reasons why there's still a difference. But I think we've come a long way. I mean, we really have come a long way. And I'm sort of a glass half full, not a glass half empty. I like to look at all the positive things that are going on in our country, and then we try to fix some of the negatives. There is some unhappiness in Ferguson, Chicago, Detroit, all the different places I've visited. There is a sort of an undercurrent of unease. I think we can fix that, and I think that's in the criminal justice system, and I think we need to make sure that the criminal justice system isn't punishing any one group of people disproportionately.
Okay, great. Thank you so much
for
your time.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. All right, thanks.